Italian journalist asked me several weeks ago, why is it, Mr. Greenaway, you started your career as a painter and now you are a filmmaker? And I very quickly said I was always disappointed that paintings didn't have soundtracks.
If you had no idea of British filmmaker Peter Greenaway's art school background, even the briefest glance at his work gives the game away. An outlier, often even a pariah in his own industry, Greenaway also prides himself on his outsider status and bold pronouncements.
We do not need a text-based cinema, you know, we need an image-based cinema. You know, it says in the Old Testament, in the beginning was the word, sorry, that's wrong, in the beginning was the image.
Agree or disagree, he certainly backs up his words with his images. Greenaway specializes in the tableau, the cinema frame displayed like a painting in a frame. He constructs theatrical, self-conscious, unapologetically intellectual presentations. There's no interest in realism. The screen teems with shifting, heavily coded color.
What is yellow?
Symbols and signifiers, visual clues and games. He even fills the frame with other frames. Greenaway loves symmetry. In fact, he surely influenced even the setup for his BAFTA interview. And when the camera isn't fixed on these overabundant images, he regularly tracks laterally across these frames, in scene after scene, film after film. The effect is a little like wandering through a gallery, moving past from one painting or exhibit to another. Indeed, paintings and artists are often included within his films, or are even their subjects.
Shall we peruse it together?
Recognizing the fine art references evidently adds greater meaning to Greenaway's films, and this can be intimidating, even off-putting. Yet when Greenaway talks of paintings with soundtracks, he doesn't only mean his film's memorable scores, with many early compositions from Michael Nyman. He also means dialogue and other audio elements.
Good God. Looks like food for constipated French rabbits.
And this is fascinating when it comes to narrative. Greenaway rejects a cinema tied to storytelling, and yet arguably his most widely appreciated film has the most conventional, genre-like story.
Yeah, I'll take his pants down!
The cook, the thief, his wife and her lover is a brutal revenge saga. Vicious, nouveau riche gangster Albert Speaker bullies his way into taking over a gourmet restaurant. His abused wife, Georgina, begins a secret affair with a bookish fellow diner, Michael, kept secret by the cook, Richard. But Albert eventually discovers them and exacts a terrible revenge, which Georgina ultimately turns back on him.
Eat Albert.
For an even more brutal comeuppance.
Open your mouth, open your mouth.
There are so many barbaric, explicit, and for many, near unwatchable incidents and images in the film, that it's impossible to show here in the same unflinching detail as Greenaway. It's been called an allegory for 1980s Britain under Margaret Thatcher, the greed is good decade, where citizens were rebranded consumers, and there are connections made between consumption and corruption, sex and death.
I'll bloody eat him! I'll kill him and I'll eat him!
Greenaway's archetypal characters are embedded into this artificial environment. Watch how the costumes, designed by fashion icon Jean Paul Gaultier, change colour to match the settings. Handling such explosive feelings and themes with such detached, controlled precision somehow turns up the emotional register from a steady simmer to a raging boil. We're both distanced spectators at an atrocity exhibition and close eyewitnesses affected by something more personal. Painting may be the frame for Greenaway's cinema, but such image stylization, synthesized, balanced even, with soundtrack, plus gripping drama, is what makes, for many people, a truly great motion picture.